are about to land in London's Heathrow Airport. The local time is 11:30 a.m. We hope you'll have a pleasant stay in London. You too, Dolly.
Well, so that seems to be in order. Thank you very much. You can go.
Thank you.
Good evening, madam. Your passport, please. Thank you. How long do you propose to stay in the country?
About 10 days.
About 10 days, I see. Miss Dolly Parton?
That's right.
And what is the reason for your visit?
I'm a performer.
You're a performer. And what do you do?
I sing.
Same reason they like it back in the United States. I think country music tells real stories about real people, very ordinary stories, and I'd like to think, in my case, told in an extraordinary way. But I think it's because it's real. I think they like it because it just talks about everyday living.
Dolly, I read once in Playboy magazine, a big interview you did, that you didn't in fact consider yourself as a sex symbol. Were you lying to them?
No, I really don't. See, I just dress the way I do because, like I say, I was impressed with, people back home. I feel sexy. I mean, I like being a woman. If I'd have been a man, I'd have probably been a drag queen.
How was working with Burt Reynolds in your last film compared to working with Lily Tomlin and Jane Fonda?
Well, there was quite a bit of difference. I enjoyed working with all of them, but I but I don't dream about Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin at night.
I'd like to have your opinion on prostitution.
Oh, I closed the whorehouse down, so I'm not one to judge or criticize, but I find that it's, something that I shouldn't really dwell on. I love everybody. I hope everybody does well. And like I say, who am I to judge? I've got enough problems of my own. Are you a prostitute?
I just hope you won't forget that the fans invite you more as a singer, not as a sex symbol.
I'll try very hard not to be a sex symbol. And I will try to sing my heart out for the fans as I always have. It is a beautiful city, and we do have better fans here than almost anywhere in the world, and we proved that tonight, right? They're the nicest people I guess I've ever known. But anyway, we want all of you to join in and have a big time. Anytime you feel like singing along with us, clapping your hands or stomping your feet, it is your show. You've paid a lot of money to come here tonight, and I want you to know that I appreciate it, because I do need the money. It takes all I make to keep up my appearance. You'd be amazed at the price of industrial bras these days. And just how much money it can really take to make a person look so cheap. So anyway, we want you to have a lot of fun tonight, which is exactly what we intend to do. And I want to go back now and do a song for you that was a big record over here many years ago. This is a story about an old redheaded girl that was trying to steal my husband. Back in the late 60s. Now, you know women do that sort of thing, right? Well, I want you to know she didn't get him. I fought that red-headed woman like a wildcat. She jerked my wig off and almost beat me to death with it. She beat the tar out of me, but I kept my husband. I got that sucker home, and I beat the tar out of him. Her name was Jolene. Smiles like a breath of spring. Your voice is soft like summer rain. Why can I compete with you, Jolene, Jolene? He talks about you in his sleep, and there's nothing I can do to keep from crying when he calls your name, Jolene.
choice of me. I could never love again, 'cause you're the only one for me. Jolene, I had to have this talk with you. My happiness depends on you, and whatever you decide to do, Jolene, Jolene, Jolene. Stalling so I can catch my breath so I can get on to the next song without screwing it up. You'd think as big as my lungs were, I could hold more air, wouldn't you? I want to calm things down just a little bit now and do a song for you that means a great deal to me. Before I go into the song, I'd like to tell you a little bit about me for those of you that don't know. I grew up in the United States, in the Great Smoky Mountains of East Tennessee. I grew up in a family of 12 children. There's 6 girls and 6 boys in our family. My mama had one on her and one in her at all times. I don't mean that with no disrespect, because my folks loved one another. You'd think they would with 12 kids, wouldn't you? But we didn't have anything that money could buy. We did grow our own food. We knew how to preserve it. We had a great love for one another, a great faith in God, and it was that kind of a thing that got us through life. And I'm sure a lot of you folks can relate to this particular song about a little ragged coat I used to wear to school. I was sure that most of you folks could relate to hard times, and I figure if you can't, well, I ain't got nothing else to say to you rich snobs anyhow. Anyway, this is a song that I hope you'll enjoy. I call it The Coat of Many Colors. The seasons of my youth, and I recall the box of reds that someone gave us, and how my mama put the rags to use. There were rags of many colors, but every piece was small. I didn't have a coat, and it was way down in the fall. Mama sewed the rags together, sewing every piece with love. She made my coat of many colors that I was so proud of. While Mama sewed, she told a story from the Bible she had read about a coat of many colors Joseph wore. And then she said, I hope this coat will bring you good luck and happiness. And I just couldn't wait to wear it. Blessed with the kiss. My coat of many colors that my mama made for me, made only from rags, but I wore it so proudly. Although we had no money, I was rich as I could be in my coat of many colors mama made. Patches on my breeches, holes in both my shoes, in my coat of many colors. But I hurried off to school just to find the others laughing and making fun of me. And my coat of many colors mama made for me. And oh, I couldn't understand that, 'cause I felt I was rich. And then I told them the love my mama sewed in every stitch. I even told him all that story mama told me while she sewed, and why my coat of many colors was worth more than all their clothes. They didn't understand it, and I tried to make them see one is lonely, poor, lonely, and they choose to be. For everybody to think that their kids are the prettiest and that their mom and dad is the goodest and that the place they're from is the only place in the world to be from, right? Well, that's how we should feel. Everybody should be proud of their home place and their folks if they can be. And I'm very, very proud of the fact that I had the kind of parents that I did and grew up in the Smoky Mountains, the Appalachian Mountains. And I've written a song that touches me very deep, and I'm sure that in your own way that you certainly will relate to this. Because as our family started to grow, we didn't have any money, as I mentioned earlier, and people started telling us that we should kind of go up north, go to Detroit, work in the Ford plant, work in the car factories, give the kids a better chance to go to better schools, and Let them get out in the world, get out in the city. Don't let them be backwoods and all this and that. And some of my people tried that. But as most of you know, that when country people try to move out into the big city, when you're way in the backwoods, it's very uneasy at times. And my folks didn't adjust too well to that. A lot of them didn't. Some of them did stay and did raise their children there. Some of them did come back. And it always moved me a great deal of how hard it was when you try to move out, be uprooted. And I think the one thing that saved us was the fact that we did have a great faith in God and we believed in Jesus. And this song, like I say, is very important to me, and I hope you like it. And if you don't like it, well, if you don't mind, I would rather not hear about it later, okay? It's a song that I call Appalachian Memories. You ought to go north, somebody told us, 'cause the air is filled with gold dust, and fortune falls like snowflakes in your hands. Now I don't recall who said it, but we live so long on credit, so we just head out to find our promised land. Just poor Appalachian farm folk with nothing more than high hopes. So we hitched our station wagon to a star. But our dreams all failing on us, 'cause there was no land to promise. And it's a struggle keeping sight of who you are. Oh, and these northern nights are dreary, and my southern heart is weary. I just wonder how the old folks are back home. But I'll keep leaning on sweet Jesus. I know he loves and guided me. Appalachian memories keep me strong. I've been thinking a whole lot lately about what's been and what awaits me. It takes all I've got to give what life demands. You'd go insane if you give in to it. Life's a meal and I've been through it. I'm just so thankful I'm creative with my hands. Not far from us, in this little old shack. He lived by himself. He had this long hair and this long beard, and he didn't take many baths, so he didn't smell real good. Mama didn't like me to go up there. She had this dreadful fear he was a dirty old man. But now you folks that know me know that I would have to find that out for myself. So on certain days when the wind was blowing a certain way, I'd hear him playing the banjo, and I figured anybody that loved music couldn't be all bad. But anyway, this is a story of my old friend Applejack, who I'm sure is playing banjo in God's Angel Band, and we're going to dedicate this to him tonight. So you have a big time with this. It always makes me feel good when I sing. He lived by the apple orchard in this little old orchard shack. His name was Jackson Taylor, but I called him Applejack. The old Applejack was loved by everyone he ever knew. Of course Applejack picked apples, but he picked the banjo too. Play a song for me, Applejack, Applejack. Play a song for me and I'll sing. Play a song for me, Applejack, Applejack. Play a song that your banjo ring. I'd go down to Applejack's just almost every day. We'd sit and we'd drink Applejack, old Applejack and me. Then he'd take his banjo down and then he'd ask me if I'd sing. He would play the banjo and I'd play my tambourine. Play a song for me, Applejack, Applejack. Play a song for me and I'll sing. Play a song for me, Applejack, Applejack. Play a song that your banjo ring. Let's play one, Applejack. Woo-hoo! Dee-dee-dum. Old Applejack is gone. Oh, but he left me the banjo and it always takes me back. You know, every time I play it, I still hear Applejack. Everybody clap your hands and sing with me. Thank you for the words. I don't care what you say. No matter. That's all. That's all for me. Applejack. Applejack.
Whitney. I bet he's looking at us now thinking, look at them people from London. Ain't they sweet? Didn't they do us proud? I used to sing an awful lot with my folks because all of my people are very, very musical. And I used to especially think I sounded good with my brothers. So I'm going to ask some of the boys to come down tonight from the band and help me sing a little bit on this one. Anyway, this is Richard. This is Jim. And dragging around in the back is... with his cord caught is Greg. Ain't that pretty? You boys ready? This is called Do I Ever Cross Your Mind? Mm-hmm. But we're going to do this with no music tonight, just us, if that's okay with the band. You hold off and we might let you play later, okay? All right. I know it's going to be hard to contain yourself, but just wait just a minute. Okay.
Oh, sometimes I go walking through fields where we walked long ago in the sweet used to be. And the flowers still grow, but they don't smell as sweet as they did when you picked them for me. And when I think of you and the love we once knew, how I wish we could go back in time. And do you ever think back on old memories like that? Or do I ever cross your mind?
Yeah. Ba-ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba.
Oh, how often I wish that again I could kiss your sweet lips like I did long ago. And how often I long for those two loving arms that once held me so gentle and close. And when I think of you and the love we once knew, how I wish we could go back in time And do you ever think back on no memories like that? Or do I ever cross your mind? When all memories appear, my eyes won't stay clear. When I think of those happier times, and do you ever recall these old memories at all? Or do I ever cross your mind? Or do I ever cross your mind?
Say thank you to the nice people that left you. You're going to help us out. Everybody clap your hands. Band, you can sing, and Eddie, you can join in with us. Strings, horns, anybody can help us if they want to. Come on, let me hear what you can do out there. Told you you were going to be a star.
So far, and you know I'm not one to let something rest. I will wear it to the ground. So let's pretend like that we have this out on a little old 45 speed record and play like we put it on the record player, or like we put it on the record player, and we flip it up on 78 speed. Now I know everybody in this house is fiddling around with your record player. Flipped one of mine down on 33 and made me sound like Porter Wagner. Well, here's how we sound on 78. You boys wound up your bins since we got here? Okay, you sure you want to try this? I'm going to embarrass you real bad. You're not going to look good with the folks back home, but that's okay. Blame it on me, all right?
Well, sometimes I go walking the fence where the walk will go, and the sweet used to be, and the flowers should grow, but they don't smell as sweet as the deer when you pick them for me. When I think of you, I miss you. Flowers, flowers, flowers. When you go back in time, and do you ever think back on the memories that you have brought up across your mind? Thank you, thank you.
Some people will do for attention, as if I hadn't done enough. Speaking of attention, when we came over here to work on the show, I really wanted to go around the city because I never really had the got to do really a lot of sightseeing, and I wanted to see Buckingham Palace, I wanted to see Piccadilly Circus, and all the glorious things that there are to see around London. And so I was riding around in the limousine, and we went by the palace, and I was doing my queen's wave, waving at everybody and saying, hi, how you doing? And then we did go down to Piccadilly Circus, and I noticed that we got a lot of punk rockers here tonight, which I'm very happy to see. I think they call them romantics now or something. But anyway, around the sitting around this fountain, I was just having the time of my life, and I was waving, and some was just looking at me. Some was going, hey, there's Dolly Parton. And this one with the purple and green and blue hair went like this. And I thought, well, I don't think my fans back home and I don't think my fans here in London would want that to happen to me. So I went like that back. Is that okay? I don't take no punk off nobody. I was the original punk rocker. Back when I started bleaching my hair, I was about 15 years old, brought up in a very religious family. And when I went home with my hair all bleached and teased all up like everybody's doing now, my old aunt had died and left me a pair of pierced earrings. And so I took a ballpoint pen and I took a needle and I pierced my ears and I had feathers and all kinds of stuff hanging out. And I had my hair all up and my mama said, oh, Lord, where did I fail? The Lord must be putting me through some kind of test. I guess I must look about like you there. She said, it must have been Satan himself make you wear your hair like that. I said, now, Mama, let's give credit where credit's due. I thought this up myself. But anyway, I was a little bit of a troublemaker, but I was a good kid. I just wanted to look a little different because I felt a little different. But my granddaddy's a preacher, and some of the greatest memories of my childhood was going to church, in all honesty, and singing the gospel songs. When they used to have the tent revivals, it was too hot in our little old church to have church in the summertime because we didn't have air conditioners. So we used to go outside. People used to come run revivals. And I may not be much, but I do know there's something greater than all of us. I have to believe that, or else I'd lose what little mind I have. But I prefer to believe it, because I do believe it. Ooh, hot August night, with the leaves hanging down, and the grass on the ground smelling sweet. to catch my breath just a second and run off and get a glass of water, put on a different dress. And you never seen that dress. Anyway, but mostly what I want to do is to feature the band on stage because, like I say, I would be very much like Miss Piggy if I wanted to hog the whole show, which I am anyway. But I want to ask Tom Rutledge and Jim Salstrom to come down and play a couple of our favorite songs back in the United States. I'm sure certainly yours. Dueling Banjos and Orange Blossom Special. So would you make them feel real welcome as soon as you're ready? How about a big hand for Tom, Jim, and all the band? I'll be right back.
Thank you.
People always wanted to. When I was a teenager, when Elvis Presley first came on the scene, you know, everybody just was freaking out over Elvis. He was the sexiest thing I'd ever seen in my life. Of course, we didn't have a television when Elvis came out, but there was an old lady who lived down the road a good ways from us. And me and a bunch of my sisters, some of my girlfriends, sneaked off from home. We knew we was going to get in trouble because they didn't want us to see all this sexy stuff, and they didn't want us slipping off from home. But I remember, I don't know when you folks first saw Elvis on television, but there was a show called The Ed Sullivan Show back home, and he was the first one that had the Beatles on, and he had all the famous groups that would, you know, come out, and he kind of really set a lot of trends in television there. But on this particular occasion, when Elvis was just the hottest thing going, they wouldn't let him show him from the waist down because all the, you know, the Elvis, the pelvis stuff, you know. So they shot him from the waist up. But they thought that kept us from seeing it in our minds, not us girls. I saw that night after night after night. I knew exactly what he was doing. But anyway, so after I saw him once, all those homely, hairy-legged boys back home just never held that much fascination to me after that. So so I went back home, and I'd get up on the hill above the barnyard, and I'd pretend like I was Elvis. I'd thought about Elvis had he been a woman. Especially one like me. If I'd been on television, they'd have shot me from the neck up back then, right? Well, anyhow, this is sort of how I used to entertain them chickens and hogs and stuff. And this is sort of how I looked. God knows I ain't no Elvis. There never will be another one. But I just thought this might be fun. And he might be watching us. He might get a kick out of it. So this is how I pictured Elvis back then, if he'd have been a girl. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Don't jive me now. I've got a little number I'd like to do for you tonight, but before I do, I want to make sure I've got a few things working. Make sure I've got all this in here. It's okay. Make sure. Oh, good grief, if we get these to roll, we'll be here a week. See this. Come back to my dressing room after the show. I'll do it for you, of course. Shook up.
Yeah.
story now that's kind of a special little song to me. A lot of folks that follow my career know that I write a lot of sad songs, and this one is absolutely pitiful.
It's true.
It's a story about a little girl and a puppy dog. And I call it Me and Little Andy. Late one cold and stormy night, I heard a dog barking. Then I thought I heard somebody at my door knocking. I wondered who would be outside in such an awful storm. Then I saw a little girl with a puppy in her arms. Before I could say a word, she said, "My name is Sandy. And here's my puppy dog, and his name is Little Andy." Standing in the bitter cold in just a ragged dress, then I asked her to come in, and this is what she said: "Ain't you got no gingerbread? Ain't you got no candy? Ain't you got an extra bed for me and Little Andy?" My mommy ran away again, and we was all alone and didn't know what we could do. I wondered if you'd let us stay with you. Daddy, a trotty horse going to the mill, can we stay all night? If you don't love us, no one will. I promise we won't cry. London Bridge is falling down. My daddy's drunk again in town. We were so alone and didn't know what we could do. I wondered if you'd let us stay with you. She was just a little girl, not more than 6 or 7. That night as they slept, the angels took them both to heaven. God knew now Sandy and her puppy dog won't ever be. Ain't you got no gingerbread? Ain't you got no candy? Don't you got an extra bed for me, Little you down. I ain't gonna let you up yet. I'm gonna do another song for you, but it's a song that I wrote when I was about 18 years old, and when I first started recording, they wouldn't let me record this on the radio because they said it was too controversial at the time. It was just a story about a girl having a baby. Not nothing that really unnatural about that, do you think? She thought somebody loved her. He left her in trouble and went away and never came back, but that seemed to be too heavy at the time, and so I only put it out in an album. But it's something I always like to sing, and I do get quite a bit of requests for it from the album, so I hope you folks will enjoy it tonight. I call it Down from Dover. Dress I'm wearing doesn't hide the secret I've tried concealing. When he left, he promised me that he'd be back by the time it was revealing. The sun behind the clouds just cast a crawling shadow o'er the fields of clover. Too long. the snow is deep upon the ground. Now I have seen the spring and the summer pass, and now the leaves are turning brown. At any time, a tiny face will show itself, cause waiting's almost over. If he doesn't hurry down from Dover. I loved him more than anything. I could not refuse him. Not when he needed me, and he needed me. He was the only one I loved, and I just can't believe that he was using me.
Smile and smile, and never hurt my defenses. to and shaking me up so that all I really know is you come again. And here I go.
You should.
wanted to scare you to death. I do want to again say thanks to all of you for being such a wonderful and sweet audience. Somebody told me once early in my career, the best thing to do to perform and to please an audience and when you know you've done the best you can is to make them laugh, make them cry, scare the hell out of them and go home. I don't know how much of that we've accomplished tonight, but I'm sure that it is late and I'm sure you folks do want to go home, as we all need to, but thank you. But anyway, I want to again say thank you for being a part of my dreams, because it is a long ways from the foothills of the Great Smoky Mountains to what they call the top of the world. I want to thank you for letting me see my little girl dreams come true, because it was always my great desire to travel around and be a so-called star, make a lot of people happy, make myself happy. And I just want you to know I love you for it. And I'll be looking forward to the next time that I get a chance to come back and be with you folks. And I want to dedicate this particular song especially to all of you. If I should stay, well, I would only be in your way. And so I'll go. And yet I know that I think of you each step of my way. And I will always love you. I will always love you. Bittersweet above all this, I wish you love.